In 1995, the video game industry was on the cusp of a revolution. Real-time 3D graphics had started to become realized, and a new generation of video game consoles were quickly arriving on store shelves. 2D games were suddenly being seen as obsolete, as the industry dived headfirst into this new, unexplored region. But while everyone was mesmerized by the possibilities of 3D, French developer Ubisoft decided to take a huge risk by investing heavily in a 2D game instead. Given the change in landscape, such a decision might have been seen as foolish, but fortunately their gamble paid off, giving birth to the company's first mainline franchise and a game that pushed them into the global spotlight. This is the story of Rayman. Of course, we can't talk about Rayman without it first mentioning his creator, Michel Ancel. Michel first discovered video games when he was around 6 or 7 years old. He grew up playing Nintendo's Game & Watch handhelds, and spent his evenings playing Pong on the Philips Video Pack. By the time he was 13, he'd already started making his own games, using computers like the Amiga and Atari ST, while also creating all of the music and graphics for them. At around 15 or 16, he met a programmer called Nicolas Schukrun, and together they worked on a game called Mechanic Warriors, a rather ambitious real-time strategy game where you battled between different groups of robots. You could even salvage components from defeated enemies to build new robots to fight with. Unfortunately, the game never came to fruition, as they were unable to secure the funds needed to continue development. It was later turned into a traditional side-scrolling shooter called Intruder, which Michel provided the visuals for, alongside another one of Nicolas's games called Pick and Pile. Around the same time, Michel participated in a magazine contest that Ubisoft was holding. He created a short animated movie with CFC molecules in the ozone layer and the oxygen that was being bullied by them. This was during a time when the ozone hole was on a lot of people's minds. While he didn't win the contest, he did receive a call from Ubisoft, who asked him to come to Paris. Despite his young age, his parents allowed him to go, and he took the train alone from Montpellier to Paris, where he proceeded to get lost in the subway. After hours and hours of searching, he eventually found their office. It was a small apartment where a lot of people spoke different languages, which really impressed him. Not long after his arrival, they received a phone call from someone in Brittany, roughly 400 kilometers to the west of Paris, who asked if Michel could go there. He took the train and arrived in the countryside, where a fancy taxi, a kind of limousine, was waiting to pick him up. After an hour's drive, they arrived at a castle, and it was here that he met one of the Guillemot brothers and founding members of Ubisoft, Gerard. While doing the ozone animation, Michel had also been working on a puzzle game called The Teller, or Brain Blasters, as it was known everywhere else. He showed it to Gerard, who asked him to finish the game for them, which he did, in about 6 months while working from home. Afterwards, Ubisoft did something quite surprising, and gave Michel one of the very first Game Boys in France before it had officially been released, and tasked him with coming up with something for the console. Since he didn't have the development kit, he moved to Brittany with his family to work at Ubisoft, and ended up being the first graphic artist they hired. However, it wasn't long until Ubisoft had to abandon their castle, as it quickly became evident just how impractical the building was. While making games inside a castle seemed like a cool idea, it wasn't worth the enormous costs needed to maintain it, with the heating bills being especially expensive during the winter. The staff were moved to a more conventional building in Paris, however, not everyone was happy with the relocation, Michel included. After half a year, he'd had enough. He wasn't comfortable in Paris, as he knew nobody, and his parents weren't able to move there due to the high costs. He was also still quite young at the time, and had grown frustrated with the structure at Ubisoft, as he just wanted to do everything himself, instead of waiting on other programmers. So, he decided to leave Ubisoft, and move back to Montpellier, where he could start work on his next project, independently. Now independent, Michel began developing his very own animation tool, using an Atari ST, and the first character to be animated in this tool was Rayman. Though it's worth noting that Rayman wouldn't actually release for the Atari ST, despite making his first appearance on one. Rayman's simple, limbless design stemmed from Michel's inability to draw, and the rendering tools of the time. He took inspiration from all kinds of Russian, Chinese, and Celtic fairy tales that he'd grown up with, borrowing different elements from each of these universes, whilst adding a more contemporary and cartoon touch, with American animator and cartoonist Tex Avery inspiring Rayman's cartoon aspects, among others. To help out with the programming, Michel recruited his friend Frederick Hood. they were both big fans of Japanese video game consoles, and during their school lunch breaks, they would often visit the arcades, so they had a pretty good idea of what their game should look like. Their sources of inspiration at the time came from games like The Legend of the Mystical Ninja, Disney's Magical Quest, and Ghouls and Ghosts. They were also big fans of technology in general, and originally imagined Rayman's world taking place inside a computer. The story was about a 10-year-old boy named Jimmy, who takes advantage of the realms that he discovers within his computer to create a fantasy world called Herit School. Called Herit's Cool. Not exactly the most imaginative name there, guys. Since the two were also big fans of nature, they wanted to create a forest slash jungle, but soon realized that their computer-themed scenario wouldn't make much sense if it were included. And so, Jimmy was cast aside, and the scenario was later rewritten to accommodate these changes. As for the fluid animation system that they'd been developing for 6 months, well, it was like nothing else in the industry at the time, and while Rayman was by no means a fully-fledged game at this point, it wasn't even close, it was enough to pique Ubisoft's interest. The two had a meeting with three of the Guillemot brothers, Gerard, Yves, and Michelle, as well as Serge Haskaway, where they showed off their animation system, as well as a picture of a giant trombone that you had to imagine the player inside. It was a rather bizarre design, but cool nonetheless. The timing couldn't have been more perfect though, as Ubisoft was looking for a way to move up in the world, and saw Rayman as their ticket to get there. They quickly made Rayman their flagship title, throwing everything they'd got into the project, and even gave Michelle free rein to choose whatever course of action he wanted. To say such an action was unprecedented would be an understatement, especially considering that 2D technology was quickly being made irrelevant thanks to the growing presence of 3D. It's also important not to overlook Michelle Guillemot's role during all of this, as Rayman's success can be largely attributed to his involvement. He invested heavily in the concept, for the time, and understood how to make games, so he ended up creating the model necessary to get the still fairly young developers on track. He also understood what they wanted to do, and helped to make them more professional. Rayman was originally in development for the Super Nintendo CD add-on, but when the hardware failed to reach store shelves, the team was left with a slight dilemma. Should they go with the 3DO, or the Atari Jaguar? They ended up choosing the Jaguar, because it was apparently the only console that could run games at 60 frames per second, which was a mandatory requirement for Rayman, due to its use of full-screen scrolling. It also helped that Frederick Hood understood how the Motorola 68000 processor that powered the Jaguar worked, as it was the same one used in the Amiga and Sega Mega Drive. The only problem they had with it was that too many graphical sprites at the same location would nearly stop the main processor. But while the team toiled away, a brand new console was about to emerge that would completely change everything. The Sony PlayStation was a literal game changer, as it was like nothing the team had known before. Not only was it far more powerful and easier to program for than the Jaguar, but it also had full CD capabilities, which was perfect for storing their giant textures. It became immediately clear that Ubisoft needed to release Rayman for the PlayStation. After all, if they stood any chance of beating Japan at platform games, then it would be to come out on a new machine faster than they could. With it being decided that Rayman would be a launch title for the PlayStation, the team soon ramped up to more than 100 people in an effort to finish the game on time. During this period, it was impressive for more than 100 people to be working on a single game. Only in Japan and the US were there teams of this size. In France, it was practically unheard of. On the 9th and 29th of September, 1995, Rayman was officially released for the PlayStation in North America and Europe respectively, alongside the release of the console itself. The game was met with critical acclaim, with reviewers praising its sharp, colourful and eye-popping visuals, as well as its fun, if not at times difficult, gameplay. It turns out the reason why Rayman was such a difficult game was because the team didn't playtest it very much, so they weren't even aware that they'd made a difficult game until it had launched. Releasing Rayman alongside the PlayStation turned out to be the right call, as there were only a handful of other PlayStation games on the market, so customers didn't have much reason not to give Rayman a try. Had the game released a year later, it likely wouldn't have been as big of a success, because there would have been far too many games to compete with. While the game's sales were good, it ended up taking approximately 18 months before it was able to turn a profit because of the enormous amount of money Ubisoft had invested in its development. Fortunately, it continued to sell well and became immensely profitable with time. By June 2003, Rayman had gone on to sell 4 million copies worldwide, and in the UK, Rayman became the best-selling PlayStation game of all time, beating both Tomb Raider 2 and Gran Turismo, which were second and third respectively. By this point, 3D games had become a staple of the video game industry, and the idea of making a 2D game made even less sense now than it did just a few years prior. Video games in almost every genre were making the leap to 3D, including mascot platformers. Some were successful, while others were not. There was no getting out of it this time. Rayman would need to make the jump to 3D, or risk being left behind. But while Rayman 2 would indeed make the jump to 3D, it didn't start off that way. In the 10th issue of Sega Saturn magazine, a 2D prototype of Rayman 2 was showcased, boasting faster-paced action and a lot more 3D elements. This prototype would later be made available in the PlayStation version as an unlockable extra. However, it wasn't long until this version of the game was scrapped, and work on a 3D Rayman game began. The transition from 2D to 3D would prove especially difficult for the team, because they had nothing to compare it to the first game. They were completely different in terms of gameplay. At the same time, it was kind of exciting, because it brought an expressive cinematic dimension to the Rayman universe. The team was able to introduce characters with many more emotions, and create scenes with various camera angles, emphasizing the characters' actions. They even tried giving Rayman arms and legs, but quickly realized how much the absence of visual limbs belonged to the character. When development of Rayman 2 started, the team was eager to dismantle the big structure at Ubisoft in order to prove that it was possible to make a game as big as ones with 100-person teams with only 6 people. They started work on the engine and everything else from scratch, just to prove to the higher-ups that a small team was capable of doing it, constantly fighting to remain small. They stayed as a 6-person team for a couple of months, before other people came in to help with the project. The benefit of starting small was that they were able to build their tools without other people getting frustrated that things weren't working, when the team was still just figuring out how to get 2 polygons on screen. They began development on PC, with a budget almost 3 times larger than that of the first game, and had managed to get the game running smoothly with large, gorgeous textures. Everything was going according to plan, until someone came in during development and told the team that their main platform was Nintendo 64. Oh dear. Suddenly, the textures needed to be 64x64 pixels and could only use 16 colors. When they tried getting the game working on the N64, it was running at 30 frames per second, with just Rayman inside a cube. One character with 12 triangles running at 30 frames per second. Needless to say, the team had a lot of constraints they needed to work around in order to get the game running on the N64, including sacrificing all of their lovely textures that they'd made for the game. Fortunately, they were later given permission to create a Dreamcast version and could use all of the original textures they'd made, so nothing was wasted. One of the biggest differences between Rayman and Rayman 2 was the scenario's greater role in the game. Now the goal was no longer to simply move from one level to the next, but to tell a story. This story-oriented approach also helped to create a much more coherent world, rather than just having a bunch of isolated levels. While designing Rayman 2, the team wanted to focus on keeping a fast pace and good rhythm to the gameplay. They noticed that most free exploring 3D games at the time would have players spending hours exploring huge environments without anything happening, even sometimes leaving the player with a feeling of not knowing where to go or what to do. So for Rayman 2, they constantly tried to make the player progress, whilst ensuring they understood where to progress to and why. When coming up with each of the game's mechanics, the team created prototypes and then handed them off to the level designers so that they could play around with them and discover new combinations. If a mechanic wasn't inspiring to them, they'd throw it out, but it wasn't quite as simple as it sounds, because the team often couldn't tell if it was the level designer or the mechanic itself that was the problem, so they'd have to test each of them out themselves just to be sure. The best part of this process was when they discovered new surprises from these ideas, emerging gameplay sequences and combinations of things that they didn't expect. They also paid special attention to the game's camera and its movements, seamlessly moving from full control to more constrained and fixed perspectives in a way that didn't feel jarring or noticeable to the player. Rayman 2's controls, meanwhile, took inspiration from Super Mario 64 instead of the more commonly used, if not slightly janky, tank controls that were present in many early 3D games. Unlike the first Rayman game, the team actually playtested Rayman 2 from the beginning of its development, and the game was shown as being fun very early on because of this. In focus groups, the team made sure that everyone, including young kids and those who had never played a 3D game before, enjoyed Rayman's controls, whilst also ensuring the difficulty of the game was set correctly. That way, the game would be relatively accessible to a large audience, and they'd be able to avoid having any millimeter difficulty, even for expert players. However, the most difficult part of Rayman 2's development was not balancing the game, but rather in teaching all of the young artists and level designers that Ubisoft brought on to help with the project. A lot of the art for Rayman 2 was surprisingly made by beginners, many of whom were just coming out of art college and had never seen or worked on a video game before. This became somewhat of a challenge for the team, as they had to explain to the artists the constraints of polygons and efficiency. The Studio Ghibli film, My Neighbor Totoro, inspired the game's color palette, and the final boss took inspiration from the robots in Studio Ghibli's Castle in the Sky. It was also animated in a very cartoonish and snappy way by animators who were making their first game, having only worked on paper before. As for the game's levels, each one was designed by two-person teams, consisting of one graphic designer who built the graphic elements of the level, and one director who created gaming experiences using said elements. One level in particular, Beneath the Sanctuary of Rock and Lava, caused quite the commotion towards the end of the game's development, thanks to some wriggling roots that one member of the team noticed looked a little unseemly at certain points. Basically, they discovered a place where there were two roots with spikes going in and out repeatedly in a most inappropriate way for a children's game. Ubisoft naturally wanted it removed, but the team never did, and they are still present in the final game. Having spent the last 5-6 years working exclusively on Rayman titles, Michel was looking for a change of pace. He decided to start work on a brand new game, codenamed Project BG&E, or Beyond Good and Evil, as we know it today. While it's true Michel was busy with his new project, it's not as if he was completely absent during Rayman 3's development. The team approached him frequently at the beginning, just to have his thoughts and feelings about their ideas. This was a good indicator for them, to see if the newness they wanted to give Rayman was faithful to the character. With the flexibility of next-gen consoles, they wanted to overhaul Rayman's look, rather than use an existing model. They remodeled him completely from scratch, using a lot more polygons for areas like the face and hands, to allow him to have a much wider range of facial expressions. Michel helped to refine their ideas, and was quite positive about the new design they'd created, as it got back to the not-to-be-taken-seriously roots of the original Rayman that was lost a little in Rayman 2. In addition to overhauling Rayman's model, the team also explored different special effects and superpowers to give Rayman all kinds of dramatic expressions and to play up his cartoonish edge. Rayman 3 was also the first game in the series to offer new outfits for Rayman, each of which imbued him with a special ability temporarily. Since most of the team had worked on previous Rayman games, they had a lot of crazy ideas for Rayman 3. Project manager Ahmed Bokhilafa did his best to stimulate the team's imagination, believing that the key to making a great Rayman game would be to cultivate the team's range of creativity to make a visually dynamic universe. For Rayman 3, they wanted to delve into the dark, unexplored realms of Rayman's world, and get away from the stale old desert, beach, and mountain locations that cropped up in platformers all too frequently. As such, they came up with a bunch of visually complex settings that varied greatly from one area to the next. The game starts out at night, in a forest filled with giant luminescent mushrooms that sparkle in the dark, and by the end of the game, the player would have traveled through shimmering temples, barren lands with bones shooting out of burning sands, dark dead lands full of forgotten stone gods, and a hoodlum factory powered by strange machines. When developing Rayman 3's mechanics, the team wanted to ensure the high action experience of the first two games remained intact, whilst also exploring how to change some of the gameplay elements. They kept Rayman's trademark moves, but used his modularity in new ways, like having him throw his two fists differently, or using his feet as a car. They also added new possibilities, with 5 time-limited superpowers. One of the biggest challenges for the team was trying to keep the essence of the original Rayman, whilst giving it a freshness that didn't betray long-time fans. Fortunately, Rayman's universe was already so rich with craziness that new and fun ideas emerged naturally. When developing the Hoodlums' AI, the team built them to think independently, so that even when they're attacking in an organized group, they'll still act for themselves, and be pretty tough to predict, in order to provide players with a challenge. They actually came up with this idea after playing Half-Life. By observing the scripted events in the game, they thought this kind of experience could change the basic fight you always see in platform games. When they created Rayman Revolution for the PS2, the system hadn't yet launched, so they didn't have time to explore all of the machine's capabilities. By the time work on Rayman 3 had started though, they'd gotten to know the hardware much better, and could better take advantage of it. They used a different engine that was specifically optimized with the types of effects they wanted in the game. For the visual aspect, they approached it quite differently from other games. First, they had the artist's approach, with illustrators and graphic designers, and then they produced special tools and effects, with engineers, so that they could apply their artist's vision. Since their lead version was the PS2, the engine and special effects were unsurprisingly optimized for that console. Specific teams were then put in charge of adapting the engine and special effects to the other platforms. For the GameCube version, they had a special team take advantage of the GameCube to Game Boy Advance link cable. For the Xbox version, they worked specifically on the brightness of the textures and the sound engine. Naturally, they encountered various difficulties adapting the same content for different hardware. For example, the RAM systems were different in the PS2 and GameCube, so they had to adapt their data for the two systems. Following the completion of Rayman 3 and Beyond Good and Evil in 2003, the Ubisoft Montpellier team went to work on a video game adaptation of Peter Jackson's King Kong, and thus was unable to begin work on a fourth Rayman title. So in early 2005, Ubisoft decided to hand off the development of the next Rayman game to Phoenix Studio, making them the first development studio outside of Ubisoft to tackle a mainline Rayman game. Thanks to the brilliant investigative work of Unseen 64, we now know what this game was planned to be. Despite working under the title Rayman 4, the game was actually intended to be a full reboot of the series. It was conceived as a revival of Rayman and took the majority of its inspiration from the first two games, in order to bring the series back to its roots. To accomplish this, they intended to reimagine levels from these two games, with levels like Bandland getting their first proper 3D rendition. Very little of the game's story, outside of the general concept, had been figured out. There wasn't even a main villain. The closest they had was Dark Rayman from the first game, who the player would encounter later on. The power-ups from Rayman 3 were also planned to play a major role in the game's levels, though many of them never actually made it into any build of the game. Additionally, they created several quirky transformations for the player to acquire, hoping it would inject plenty of variety into the gameplay. The game was in development for around 10 months, with a great deal of pre-production being spent carefully crafting the art of each level, along with some prototyping. But in late 2005, all work on the project suddenly came to a halt. At E3 of that year, Nintendo had unveiled their latest console, codenamed Revolution, or the Nintendo Wii, as we know it today. While the announcement had been expected, it still managed to worry certain members of Ubisoft, who feared the success of their late GameCube projects, including Rayman 4. Not long after, Ubisoft began receiving the first batch of development kits for the console, right as work on the King Kong game was drawing to a close. Michel had previously been too busy to contribute towards Phoenix's Rayman 4 game, but as development of King Kong wrapped up, they began exploring new ideas, and a small team started pre-production, working on prototypes for the next Rayman game. It was at this point that Ubisoft decided to cancel Phoenix's Rayman 4 game, and reverted back to Ubisoft Montpellier to handle the next Rayman instead. Development soon picked up once King Kong went gold, with the entire Montpellier team, around 70 people, switching over to the new Rayman, with the goal to release the game on next-gen consoles for the Christmas holiday season. This new incarnation of Rayman 4, Raving Rabbids, was originally planned as a single-player action-adventure game, similar to the previous Rayman games. There were no plans of having any multiplayer, as the team wanted to focus on offering a great single-player experience instead. The game was going to be completely open, allowing players to freely navigate and move from situation to situation, with different companions, items, or dark creatures. An early trailer for Rayman Raving Rabbids showcased what this earlier build of the game looked like, whilst also demonstrating the Wii's unique motion controls and how the game would potentially make use of them. However, this build of the game was very different from what players eventually got. At some point during development, Michel realized that it would be useless to make the same kind of adventure game he would have made for the PS2, and so the team moved to a more party-focused game which better fitted the Wii console. Rayman Raving Rabbids was released for the Wii on the 19th of November and 8th of December 2006, in North America and Europe respectively, alongside the release of the console itself. Despite the game's rather significant change, it still received positive reviews, with critics praising the game's sick sense of humour and heavy emphasis on fun, as well as the design of the rabbits themselves, though some of the minigames were criticised for being mediocre. Since Ubisoft now considers the rabbits to be their own separate franchise, I won't go into each and every instalment. Suffice it to say, the game sold well, so many sequels were released, and by 2014, the Rabbids franchise had collectively sold 14 million copies worldwide. While the Rabbids games were far from unsuccessful, they weren't exactly what you'd call true Rayman games, at least not in the eyes of fans. The Rayman community was hungry for a new platform game, and, as luck would have it, their prayers were about to be answered. At Ubisoft's E3 2010 press conference, Rayman Origins was officially revealed to the public. It was originally planned to release as episodic content, as big games take a long time to create, and the team believed that episodes would allow them to imagine a longer, more developed saga. The first episode was set to release by Christmas 2010, with the remaining episodes launching in 2011. But by May 2011, reports started circulating that Rayman Origins was no longer episodic, and was in fact a full retail release, set to launch in the holiday season. The reports were true, and it turns out this change was made due to the game being power-up based. The team realised that it would be better to have levels that teased players about a new power that you could go back and use to explore new locations once you've unlocked them. This was very hard to do with episodic content, as the player might not purchase all of the previous installments. The idea for Rayman Origins first came about when Michelle wanted to recreate something with a small team. The project started with just 5 people, but eventually grew to almost 100 people over the course of its development. Michelle first began by putting together a small team to make some tests in a new 2D engine they were developing. All an artist had to do was paint a concept, cut a piece out, save it out in an alpha channel, drag and drop it, and it was in the engine, ready to be scaled, moved, rotated, coloured, etc. It was extremely easy for artists and designers to create content in this engine because it was built with the artists in mind. They called this tool the UbiArt Framework, and it was specifically built for Rayman Origins by the Ubisoft Montpellier team. With this tool, a graphic artist was not only able to express their ideas in the form of just a simple picture, but with an actual playable prototype, allowing the team's creativity to flourish. In other engines, it was often difficult to modify the game or add new content because you needed to do a dozen other things before you could implement what you wanted, stifling creativity. The UbiArt framework was liberating because it had no such restrictions. For Rayman Origins, the team focused on creating surprises for the player. They wanted to recreate the same feeling you had when playing classic 16-bit platformers, where you'd always wonder what was next, and where players were rewarded through exploration. Michelle loved the idea of letting the player play at their own pace, whether that be to simply reach the end of the level, or stay longer to discover all of the level's secrets. When developing the game, Michelle worked with narrative director Gabriel Schrager to think about the characters they wanted to bring back, and how to create a more coherent universe so that new players, who had never played a Rayman game before, could explore this universe for the first time and not feel lost. According to artistic director Celine Tellier, the team wanted to revisit all of the joys of the first Rayman game, a platformer with a lot of visual richness. The first Rayman game was made by artists from outside the video game industry, and they wanted Rayman Origins to be the same. They began the project with the idea of going back to the artistic dimension of Rayman's universe, and wanted to work with traditional painters, illustrators, and artists in animation studios. They also wanted Rayman Origins to remain true to Rayman's world, a bit political, and at the same time, very humorous. Playtesting, unsurprisingly, played a huge role in the game's development, as the team wanted beginners to learn at their own pace. At the same time, they realised that a game made for beginners would have been dull for more experienced players, so they decided to populate the game with a lot of really hard challenges to combat this. Knowing full well that the skill range between beginners and veteran players was quite large, they created each level with both groups in mind. They also needed to create progression for both types of player, one more about skills and bragging rights, the Achiever levels, where you end up chasing chests that take you in very dangerous places, and one more about surprise and discovery, the Explorer levels, where you defeat the Electoon guards. Multiplayer platforming was another big focus of Rayman Origins. The team wanted everybody to play and enjoy the game together, even when players have different skill sets. They wanted gamers to be able to play with their significant other, who maybe doesn't enjoy playing video games. This proved to be quite the challenge, but after a lot of testing, they arrived at something that compared similarly to other games, but with a few unique features specific to Rayman Origins. For example, the beat-em-up aspect of the game brought a lot to differentiate it from others. The team did a lot of modification to the core gameplay to make it as fun to play alone as it was to play with others. They ditched the concept of lives, as they seemed like a remnant of the arcade era, when the designers needed to throw the player out of the game after an average of 3 minutes of play. Instead, they designed the game in a more positive way, where failure is less of a big deal, and instead just a missed opportunity to get something valuable that you might achieve later when you're skilled enough. Developing and tweaking Rayman's controls required a huge amount of work, and there were so many parameters to tweak that it could almost be frightening at times. But considering these controls were the base of the whole game, if they didn't work properly, it could ruin the entire experience. After 2 years of development, Rayman Origins was released for the Wii, PlayStation 3, and Xbox 360 in 2011. The game received widespread critical acclaim, with reviewers praising its gorgeous visuals, tight controls, and perfectly judged difficulty curve. However, despite its widespread critical acclaim, Rayman Origins was only able to sell 50,000 copies during its first 4 weeks on sale in the US. The UK fared similarly poorly, with the game failing to break into the top 40 during its debut week. It didn't help that Rayman Origins released during a difficult time, surrounded by huge M-rated AAA titles. The Rayman brand had also been inactive for several years, and people didn't really know what to expect from this new title, which likely explains why sales were slow at the beginning. But while sales were poor, it was still able to become a profitable title for Ubisoft, and a long-term seller for the company. After work on Rayman Origins had wrapped up, the team were asked if they were interested in making a sequel. Since many of them wanted to stay on and begin a new adventure, they were more than happy to start work when a sequel was greenlit. Rayman Legends was first leaked back in April 2012, when a new Arkham Ford marketing survey mentioned the upcoming sequel of Rayman Origins, with a video showcasing some early gameplay footage. Around the same time, Ubisoft registered the domain names RaymanLegends.com and Rayman-Legends.com. Not long after, a trailer for Rayman Legends on Wii U was leaked, showcasing the console's graphical power, touchscreen tablet, and near-field communication capabilities. Ubisoft responded directly to the leak by confirming that Rayman Legends was in fact in development, but that the leaked video was intended as a purely internal demonstrative video and in no way represents the final game, the final console, or their features. At the beginning of Rayman Legends development, the team decided that they wanted to have more diversity than Rayman Origins. They wanted every level to bring something new and different to the table, to keep on surprising players throughout their adventure. They also wanted to make sure that the game would have a bigger scope, so they decided to add an online challenge mode and a soccer minigame called Kung Foot. These additions, plus the 40 modified levels from Rayman Origins, helped to make Rayman Legends feel twice as large. The first key idea they had was for each of the worlds to be inspired by famous myths or legends. This way, they could all think along the same lines and come up with many crazy ideas. Ubisoft was very keen on having the team take risks with Rayman Legends, so they decided to begin development on Wii U, as it was an area of experimentation. The Wii U inspired all of the touch gameplay surrounding Murphy and the co-op experience associated with it. Controlling Murphy on the Wii U gamepad to open up the path for other players proved to be a really great gameplay experience that was perfect for the team because it also added a lot of diversity to the game, which is what they wanted. The UbiArt framework also received a lot of improvements, such as added online multiplayer, a dynamic lighting system, touchscreen gameplay, and support for 3D elements, which all helped to give the feeling that Rayman Legends' world was more alive. Another difference in Rayman Legends was the addition of musical levels, where the rhythm of the music dictates the pace of the action. These levels first came about after an internal meeting where they showed a video to Ubisoft CEO Yves Guillemot of one of their level designers playing a very difficult level in the game. They wanted to make it as fun as possible, so they added the heavy metal track, Antisocial, and synced it to the actions of the player. Everyone loved it, but when it came to actually turning this idea into a real gameplay experience, the team needed to do a lot of iterations because it wasn't easy to synchronize, and they needed players to still feel in control of what was happening on screen. While designing the game's levels, the team made sure that speedruns were possible, meaning a player could finish them in one run without stopping or waiting too much. They also spent a lot of time thinking about how to please different types of players. They figured that, most of the time, simply finishing a level shouldn't be too hard or frustrating, but collecting all of the elements hidden in a level, like the Teensies for example, should be a lot harder. The macro structure of Rayman Legends was also built around this idea, with the game having a more open structure where several levels unlocked at the same time, guaranteeing that players would never get stuck. The Wii U gamepad also proved to be a great opportunity for players with different skill levels to play together. The team knew that anyone can play on a touchscreen nowadays, like a little kid or someone who doesn't know how to use a game controller, so someone who had never played a game before could control Murphy on the Wii U gamepad, while the more experienced players would control classic characters on the TV. It was also important to avoid putting too much information on the screen that served no real purpose, so that it wouldn't confuse players. This was especially true for the Wii U version, which could have up to 5 players at once. If everyone had a complex HUD, it could get very confusing very quickly. During the game's development, the team found a lot of ways to improve the controls, even though they were already working great in Rayman Origins. One example of this is with the air attack move. In Rayman Origins, the player would lose their momentum when performing this action, but in Rayman Legends, the team changed it so you didn't lose the speed of your jump, and they discovered players were more likely to use this move as a result. Rayman Legends was originally developed as a Wii U exclusive, and was supposed to launch alongside the console on the 18th of November 2012, but was later delayed to February 2013. When it became clear that the Wii U was a flop, Ubisoft decided to delay the game again, this time by 6 months, and make it a multi-platform release instead. The game's delay gave the team time to include a lot of things that they didn't have time to put into the first version. At the end of a game's development, there are always cool ideas left on the table, because it's impossible to include absolutely everything. But with the delay, they were able to add everything they wanted to. For example, they added giant 3D bosses at the end of each world, and also added invasion levels, where players have to race against the clock to save tinsies attached to rockets that are about to take off. When porting the game to the PS3, Xbox 360, and PC, the team spent a lot of time thinking about how best to adapt the Murphy gameplay, which used the touchscreen of the Wii U gamepad. It was important for them to keep Murphy as one of the main characters, because he brought a lot of diversity to the game, but they needed to change the gameplay related to him to make sure it would still work well on these other systems. They settled on the idea of having Murphy moving by himself, stopping at elements that he can interact with. Then, with a simple button press, the player would be able to give orders to Murphy to carry out his specific actions. This change required them to modify entire levels in these versions of the game to make sure this new Murphy gameplay worked well on these systems. While the delay did allow the team to add in the features they wanted and polish up the game further, it didn't exactly go over well with fans. A pair of which journeyed to Ubisoft Montpellier in order to protest the delay, and Michelle made the ill-advised decision to be photographed with them. When he arrived at work that morning, he saw the two fans holding a Save Rayman placard. They asked him to come take a picture with them, and the photo soon appeared online, raising eyebrows within Ubisoft itself, with the initial reaction being that he and his studio were the ones protesting the company's decision. That isn't to say some developers weren't annoyed at the decision. A former Ubisoft employee, who left the company at the end of January 2013, explained that they had just finished a crunch period to get the Wii U version ready. They'd been practically working overtime since May, preparing for E3, and then almost a demo per month for other venues and storefronts, whilst also trying to actually finish the game at the same time. The first delay, from the Wii U's launch to February 2013, came about because it was obvious that they couldn't finish the game on time, but they gave it their all to have it ready by February, only to then be told that the game was being delayed again. Considering that many members of the team had barely been able to see their spouses, kids, and friends for months because of the crunch period, this was a rather difficult pill for some of them to swallow. It's been 6 years, as of this video's recording, since Rayman Legends first hit store shelves, and many fans have been left wondering when Rayman will return. Hopefully we'll get to see the Limbless hero spring into action once again in the not-too-distant future. If you enjoyed this look back at the Rayman franchise, and would like to see more documentaries like this in the future, then please let me know by liking this video and subscribing to my channel. If you want to see all of my sources and research notes for this video, then feel free to follow the link in the description below to a public Patreon post where I've listed them. And while you're there, if you're able to throw a dollar or two my way, then that'd be most appreciated.